finding out a lot more about the Alaska Airlines plane that lost part of its fuselage mid-flight on Friday.
Aircraft design expert Jaime Klopp joining us now. So many questions about what happened. How does that happen?
Well, a hole in the fuselage is very rare event, but I like to point out that a fuselage is like a balloon, and when you have lots of air in a balloon and it pops, the air comes out immediately and rapidly, and that's what happened in this case.
I think the last couple of days we've learned more than we ever thought we needed to about that's not an emergency door, that's actually a door plug.
Yes.
I don't think most normal passengers on an airplane knew that they had that. Explain what that is.
Operative word is plug. It's not a door. It's it can be a door in certain configurations on the airplane. So in this case, not required to have an emergency exit there. So the Boeing and the airline will put a plug in place. This saves weight, saves cost, allows a full-size window. And as a passenger in the airplane, you don't know it because it's a normal interior panel. There's no escape door.
So now that's kind of what they're looking at now, whether that was built properly, that was positioned safely enough, obviously, because it seems to just kind of pop right off.
Yes, of course. So the plug departed the aircraft, and rapid depressurization, and that is the focus of the investigation. How could this happen?
It's amazing from what they've been reporting. Nobody was sitting in that seat. That was
extreme coincidence,
right?
That's interesting.
There was a kid in the row in the middle, maybe.
Middle,
and I don't know any kids who don't want the window seat.
Right.
So. Maybe conspiracy theories are open too.
Maybe something will pop up. But in the video and the clips that we've seen, it seemed very calm on the plane. We've heard different reports of, you know, what was actually happening, what the pilots were doing. But take us through, I'm just wondering, if you're flying on a plane, which most of us have been on, and then there's like a piece of it missing, what does that feel like? And did it feel like for the passengers on that plane? Is it windy? Is it cold? Is it?
It would be all of those things. So we don't have to speculate because we have passenger reports and some video, and calm in the minutes after the event. Credit to the passengers and the crew, they were very calm. I think it would have been terrifying to be anywhere near this this row. And looking out at the night sky, extremely loud, the rapid depressurization would have moved air, all of the air from the cabin, from the forward and backward, just out immediately. So that removed interior panels and caused damage. And then, of course, the oxygen masks drop right away. And the thing you were always told about but hope to never see, crazy.
Yeah, I think it's one of those things that everybody will think about now. I was just telling you, commercial break, I had friends that canceled flights after this. And you just sit with all the emergency things and you see the flight attendants telling that most people have their heads down because you're not paying attention. You just don't think things like this are going to happen in a flight, but they did. And you trust that the airlines are doing what they need to do with those safety inspections. You know, sometimes flights are delayed because there's something wrong with the plane. There's now a word coming out that the pressurization warning light went off during three separate flights prior to this. So in the airline world, how does that work? Because sometimes a light will go off. It does in our check engine light. Like, we'll get to
it. Well, that's correct. So if the reports are true that the caution lights were present in the pressurization system in previous flights, it is routine. There are things that happen. Their maintenance, the crew will make a note of it. Maintenance events might occur. If in the end, this investigation points back to those warning lights as being part of the accident chain, that will be, I guess, a tragic.
So it's routine that if a light like that goes on, you still fly the plane, just like they said, not over water. What does that matter if it's over
that's
water?
The over water thing is a specific Alaska decision I don't know enough about.
Sure.
Aircraft have tons of complicated systems, and warning lights and maintenance is ongoing always. Yeah. So unknown if the investigation will point back to these particular pressurization warnings.
We talked about whether it was coincidence or what about that nobody was sitting in that particular row, but explain in terms of just pure luck or coincidence that this happened at 17,000 feet right after takeoff versus once you reach cruising altitude at 35,000 feet. Had that happened at that altitude, it would have been a whole different story.
Yeah, not necessarily coincidence. The aircraft is undergoing it changes in profile as the pressurization is increasing in the pressure vessel going up to altitude. The differential from inside and outside the airplane is increasing, so it's changing. It's not stabilized yet. Maybe a more likely, certainly a more likely time to see
if something like that's going to happen.
That's so I don't think coincidence that this failure occurred during that flight profile. But as you note, the higher higher speeds, higher pressure.
Yeah.
Differentials in cruise flight would have been different, and we've seen that in the past.
Before we let you go, what do you think investigators are going to look at here, and what do you think are some of the possible causes? Not asking you to predict specifically here, but what do you think could be the reason for this?
So possible causes include everything from a design flaw to materials flaws or missing parts, missing quality control checks, which would have identified those missing parts or assembly errors, and I think investigators will look at all of those. And
it's still amazing no one was seriously hurt and nobody was sitting in that seat, because we would have been talking about something completely different
this morning. I think that was survivable. Seeing the photos, I think that was survivable if you had been sitting in that seat. I'd like to think it would have been okay, but
scary.
Gives you a reason when they say, when you're sitting down, not move around the cabin, keep your seatbelt on.
Keep your seatbelt on.
Wow. Okay. So what's next in terms of all these planes are grounded? How long is this going to take to get all these planes back off the ground?
I don't have a guess on that. I think it's the NTSB investigations. Time is measured in weeks and months, not days, but the airlines and the have their own metrics.
Sure.
We'll have to wait and see.
All right, Jaime Klopp. Aviation design expert, we thank you for the time.
Thank you.